Hi, I'm Sandra Campos. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak to you today and to be a part of this Design Nation conference. I was honored and really appreciate the opportunity to be able to share my knowledge, my experience, and my story with you today. Growing up in a Mexican-American family in the middle of Texas, I learned a lot through my immigrant parents who were very entrepreneurial, who opened up their own tortilla factories and allowed me the ability to really see and discover what it meant to be an entrepreneur, what it meant to be responsible for everything from manufacturing to supply chain to distribution and logistics, as well as sales. So I always knew that business was going to be in my career trajectory. And for fashion, it was natural. It was only natural for me to go into fashion because I grew up making clothes for my siblings, making slip covers for my mom's sofa, and changing the curtains every other month. It was always in my blood that I wanted to have a creative outlet and I wanted to be part of an industry that was constantly moving and changing. While I had some great courses in marketing and business in college, I also really gained the majority of my experience through hands-on real-life training. When I first moved to New York City, I had three jobs for the first 3 years. I came to work in sales, and I was working for a company that was selling products to various retailers. Brand at the time was called J.G. Hook. I then also worked in the evenings in a retail store, selling in a retail store on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. And on the weekends, I was working for a buying office in the same company that had multiple retail stores throughout the city. I was working in the buying office, helping out in terms of production orders and merchandising. What I realize now is that those were actually the very basis of what I do today in terms of product, in terms of everything is about the consumer. And so when you have a product that you're selling, whether it's apparel or it's footwear or it's deodorant or anything else, you have to keep the consumer in mind. So having her top of mind and being with and surrounded by the consumer was something that was extraordinarily important to me. One of the first jobs after that I had going into more of a wholesale structure, I had the ability to travel all around the country. And I was going to places like Edina, Minnesota, to Indianapolis, Indiana, and all places all throughout the middle part of the country, which in the southern part of the country as well, Knoxville, Tennessee. And what that did for me was it really gave me an exposure to a whole different group of individuals, what their culture was, what their likes and dislikes were, what the demographics were in the area, what the weather patterns were. And that was a really big eye-opening experience because as I lead brands that are creating products, not all cities are alike and not all customers are alike, not only in terms of size and job and lifestyle, but also in terms of what the temperature is where they live. In January, it's different in Miami than it is in New York. So you have to be able to focus on that. You know, not only is it different in Brazil versus if you're shipping product to Australia or London, Hong Kong, etc. So you have to really contemplate how to structure a business that's really supporting global consumers out there based on all the various aspects of what they live with. So while I was packing lunches every day for my kids on their way to preschool, I had Ziploc bags that were just too plain for someone who was involved in fashion every day. So it seemed like a natural to be able to apply color, pattern, fun designs onto plain and simple bags that everybody would use. So being a mother, being the demographic that I was going to target, I knew exactly what they would want. So starting from business from scratch is not easy, and it definitely takes more than one person. So I always say that one person does not a business make, because you really need to have partners. And there's just so many different facets in starting a business that range from production, finding factories, manufacturers, supply, you know, materials, whatever it is that you're utilizing. And in our case, for plastic bags, it was multiple materials that needed to be done, as well as the packaging. Design, in terms of the creative elements of it, marketing, in terms of taglines and ads and press and PR moments and events and gifting, to distribution and sales and showrooms and salespeople, and then accounting and finance and customer service and website and all the e-commerce digital ads and all the e-commerce and all the e-commerce specifics that need to be managed when you're running a website. So it's very difficult and challenging for one person to do. So I always suggest to founders that they have multiple founders that can actually split the tasks and split the responsibilities in the areas of focus. So the designer that we had really was focusing on some of the classics. We had classics that were stripes, plaid, polka dots. Those were our essential line. We kind of took a lot of the things that we knew from fashion and applied it into this consumer strategy. As well as then when we'd have seasonal holiday, we would focus on hearts for Valentine's Day, bunnies with psychedelic neon bunnies for Easter. It was not very traditional. They were definitely very fashion oriented. We also started doing collaborations before anyone was doing collaborations. We did collaborations with designers. We did collaborations with museums. We did collaborations with SeaWorld. So we had real collaborations where we actually designed and created designs with those designers, co-branded it and co-marketed on our outside packaging, as well as our press and all of our marketing materials. After Moby, I transitioned to another entrepreneurial venture, launching a brand, Dream Out Loud by Selena Gomez. Round and round. At the time that we were starting our celebrity brand management company, there weren't really many celebrity brands out there, and there certainly weren't any for teens. And because I had small kids in my house, I was watching Wizards of Waverly Place every weekend, and I was on the Disney Channel, it was on my TV, and I really felt that there was an opportunity to find a teen who was not only iconic for young kids, but also a great role model and a great mentor. And so Selena Gomez was one that we believed had that long-term ability to be able to be someone who was really unique, who was very authentic, and who young kids could aspire to be. So when we actually created that company and created that brand, it was all about teens giving back positive affirmations. That was the tone of the messaging, that was on the product, and that didn't exist at the time. Don't be afraid to bring your personal life into your business life. You know it the best. There are things in your life that you know are missing. That's where you can find some of those white space opportunities that don't exist in the market, or if there's something that already exists that you can make even better. So even though oftentimes you want to separate business and personal, in this case, I have found that for me, my personal has been very attached and very tied and connected to my business. So I had corporate experience. I was an entrepreneur. I wanted to go back to be in a corporate role again, and I wanted to lead businesses once more. So I joined Global Brands Group, which is a $4.5 billion company that essentially had many brands that they were designing and turning around from founder-led businesses that had either gone bankrupt or that needed to be turned around financially. So leading those businesses from a design standpoint was all about going back and finding once again, what was the original ethos of the brand? What was the original DNA? Who was the original customer? How did they find that original passion? What was the brand about and who was it designing for? So some of the brands that I led, Juicy Couture being one perfect example, had its heyday in the early 2000s when the two designers that created the brand really found a niche in something that didn't exist. And that was in terry velour pants and matching hooded sweatshirts. So they did something that wasn't out there. They made it cool. It's something that still exists today, but we wanted to go back to the DNA of what made that really relevant, important, and global. So that's the first thing we did. Anytime that we took a brand over and tried to turn it around was to say, you know, what was the original ethos? And what does the brand stand for? How is it differentiated? How is it different than what exists today? Because oftentimes brands are started in one decade and then they end up multiple decades later needing to be turned around, revived, and modernized. You've seen many of those examples out there across the board, especially in fashion. The key difference that I have found in my career from being an entrepreneur to working in a corporate world is that you have a lot more resources and you are much more siloed. So as an entrepreneur, most people in an entrepreneurial type of organization will wear many hats, and you'll have multiple jobs, and you'll be much more agile, and you can make decisions a lot more quickly when you don't have multiple layers of individuals to work through. In a more of a corporate job and a more structured organization, there are structured processes and milestones, and not necessarily as agile as you can be in smaller organizations, because there are steps, there's layers of individuals and executives that have to be able to answer and make decisions. The key difference being the agility factor and also decision making, because as an entrepreneur, you actually have a lot of input, and sometimes in corporate existence, you may not have as much input, or you may not be heard as well as you would be if you had your own business or in a smaller group of individuals. So after years of running businesses that had names on a label, I really wanted to be a part of something that was really socially relevant and that had a real message and a purpose behind it. So when I joined as the CEO of Diane von Furstenberg DVF, a 45-year-old brand, it was something that I realized was incredibly important, that what we stood for as a brand and the purpose that we've had for all these years was to help empower women and help their inspire their confidence. And that's something that I hear every single day from women, that they're connected to the mission, they're connected to the content that we create, that isn't just about buying product, but it's really about helping them to feel more knowledgeable, to feel more confident, to be able to do what they do every day, whether they're a housewife or whether they're standing in front of a board meeting, that they're able to do that better. And they're learning from each other and they're learning from us as well.
It was Diana Vreeland who I met, who at the time was editor-in-chief of Vogue magazine. I mean, everybody had seen those dresses and nobody really paid that much attention to it. And when she saw them, she said, genius, wonderful, wonderful, and then threw me out of the outfit. Well, the things that inspire me the most, first, of course, women. Women inspire me. How they are, how they move, what they wear. My role model was always Marlene Dietrich. She was glamorous, she was strong, she was beautiful, she was free, she understood lighting. And then nature, because in nature you find everything, every shape. It could be anything from a rock to a leaf, stones. I mean, bark is the most beautiful pattern, but very close up. Look, wouldn't that make a beautiful fabric? Art. You know, you go and see a Gauguin, the color palette of Matisse is just so extraordinary. You don't need to go any further than that. I really did come on the boat with my hopes. I had samples of dresses in my suitcase. My dresses made me live an American dream, so.
But at the end of the day, everything is back to product. It all starts with product and it ends with product, because when we're trying to sell a consumer a product, you have to think about them from the beginning and you have to think about them at the end of the process. So in the case of DVF, it's all about the wrap dress. And this is the one iconic piece that she created all those years ago. Simple, functional, utilitarian, very easy, no zippers, no buttons, something to help empower women at a time in the 70s when there weren't that many women in the working world, but there are a lot more now, and it's still the same dress that's out there. From a sustainability standpoint, I can't think of another brand outside of Chanel and Hermes that really have, and maybe Louis Vuitton, that have as much product that exists out there in resellers as we do today at DVF. And that's because of the quality that we deliver, that's because of the longevity and the timelessness of the design, and that's incredibly important in the brand value, in terms of how long this brand lasts and what the legacy is that's being created by a brand. So the fact that we can actually have a purpose behind our brand and create a wrap dress that inspires all, that's something that's been incredibly important to me as a career. And from a design standpoint, again, really making sure that we fit all sizes, that we're providing opportunities for someone who can be pregnant and the wrap dress grows with her, for somebody who might be a plus size 1 year and another size another year, that's something that we offer as well. And that, again, from a design standpoint, is the user functionality. It's the versatility of what we offer, where you can wear it to a wedding, you can wear it to a board meeting, or you can wear it to a PTA meeting, anything in between. So we all know that fast fashion has really been important in the last 10 years, whether it's Zara, H&M, Forever 21, there's thousands and thousands of stores around the globe, and they've done a good job at what they've done. The difference there, and we all own a piece from any of those retailers, but the difference is it's disposable. And what we do at DVF, and what I've done in a lot of the businesses that I've been a part of, is really much longer term and much longer lasting. It's about quality, it's about sustainability, it's about providing a value and something that will live on. So within DVF, as an example, we have so many women on a regular basis and so many hundreds and thousands of stories that we have from women that have come in and worn their grandmother's dress that was handed down to them, or their mother bought them their first dress when they had their first job interview, or when they got their first real job, they had saved up their money and they bought their first DVF dress because they knew how powerful they were going to feel in that dress. And it's, you know, we have an example that Diane shares all the time, which is that Anne Hathaway was actually conceived in a wrap dress and her mother still has that wrap dress. We have women who've been pregnant and had their children in wrap dresses. So there's all kinds of stories, and that's incredibly personal, obviously, when you have those situations that you're a part of. But from a design standpoint, that's something incredible too, to see women who have lived in these dresses for so many years and through so many decades. I have designers that are so proud when they see people walking down the street in their product, and especially when they see bestsellers and people that are really inspired and sharing on social media, because they've created something that helps women feel good, that helps them do what they do even better, and that's the ultimate success from a design standpoint. So I've given you a lot of examples, from very small startups that I personally was involved with to very large corporate organizations that I've also been and had the fortune to be a part of, and everything in between. Throughout all of those experiences, there are a few things that just don't ever change, especially as I go in and I advise different brands on turnarounds, or I advise startups in terms of how they're looking. One is to always focus on your consumer. Make sure you know exactly who your audience is. Two is to make sure that you're consistent. Consistent with your message, consistent with your product quality, consistent with your with what you do and who you are, and you don't change who you are based on the trends or based on the time and the culture, and you know, whether it's COVID or it's non-COVID. You can't change who you are as a brand. Staying consistent and having the power to be consistent and to say no is one of the most important things that you can do and that you can learn, that no one will ever tell you in a textbook. But saying no and making sure that you're sticking to your guns on who you are and what your brand is absolutely key, and that will never change. Listen, we're sitting here during a time of quarantine, and we all are surrounded by what will be next. Questions that no one has answers to. There's no playbook, there's no rule book. No one's ever been through COVID or any type of pandemic like this throughout our lifetime. It already has changed the landscape of retail. Our stores have been closed for more than 2 months now. Most retailers have, anything that's non-essential at least. And what it will do, as we've all been sitting around our homes, we're paying more attention to what's surrounding us. We're paying more attention to loungewear, sleepwear, things that are more about being at home and spending time at home. And we know that everything will change after this. It's going to take a long time to recover. It's going to take a long time to be able to feel good about getting on a plane again, packed full of people, or being in a conference packed full of people, and what that means. And what that means in terms of the workplace. You know, we don't know if we're going to go back to the same open space workplace. Are we going to go back to having to wear dresses that are $500 dresses? Are we going to go back to weddings being the social occasions, but the only time that you go and you have any need for that type of product? So it's really making all of us in design look at what's most important. Quality over quantity, first and foremost. Making sure that we are differentiating the product that we create and that we develop is the second piece. And making sure that we stay very, very connected in building our community, who that customer is, and what they want and need in their lives. One of my pieces of advice that I share is to make sure that you stay informed. Stay culturally relevant. Make sure that you understand and watch and see what's happening around you, what consumers are interested in. Really stay up to date with reading different different media outlets, looking at social media, making sure that you know what's happening for various demographics. And there's a lot of content out there, and there's a lot to keep up with, but certainly keep up with technology and understand what's happening around the globe. So I stay very informed through a lot of different outlets that I subscribe to that I get on a daily basis. And I'll spend at least a couple of hours a day reading through those to just try to keep up to date with everything that's going on. As the industry is changing and the fashion industry will evolve more and more, we need to have an industry that's much more focused on combining technology with fashion design, with entertainment and experience, because that is going to become more and more relevant. We can't any longer just have clothes hanging on a rack and hoping that people are going to come in and buy it. There needs to be a message and a passion and a purpose, and there needs to be content that supports a creative element and experience that people feel, whether it's digitally or whether it's in store. So we need innovative thinking. We need thinking, and you know, whether it's AI, AR, we need new technology and data that will help us improve our decision making. And that is where the future will lie. Design is very important in everything that we do and everything that we see and experience. In this current role that I have and the company that I lead, design is what helps women feel more powerful. It helps inspire confidence. That's pretty significant. And if you are fortunate enough to be able to be a part of organizations and design products that will help people live better lives, you've made a real impact. Thank you so much for listening. I'm excited to see what you all contribute to the design community as young professionals, and I wish you the best of luck.